determined by the rules of the Dominican Boxing Court of the
Waves. There's no fear in either man. There is no fear in George Foreman. He's grown enormously in his confidence of speech and presence, as well as in boxing. Angie Dundee, Ali's trainer, right next to me, is saying it. You may hear him. Down goes Frazier! Down goes Frazier! Down goes Frazier! The heavyweight champion is taking the mandatory 8-count, and Foreman is as poised as can be in a neutral corner. Frazier is dazed. You see the countdown for the first round. Foreman has not panicked. Foreman is going about his job. Foreman is all over Joe Frazier. Frazier is down again, and he may be. No, he is rising. He is game. He doesn't know where he is. The mandatory 8-count. He doesn't know where he is. Now the round is about to end. Two knockdowns in the first round of Joe Frazier. Down again. No saving by the bell. He's up, and so the fight continue. Three knockdowns in the first round by George Foreman. A caution from Arthur Mercanic. Oh, he is all over Frazier again. He has Frazier in the corner. Frazier's knees buckled. He is down for the fourth time in the fight. George Foreman is doing to Joe Frazier what he did as a 19-year-old to a veteran Russian, a fellow named Ioannis Chapulis, in October of 1968 in the Mexico City Arena. A quick left from George. Another. Frazier is down for the fifth time in this fight. Fifth time. Three times in the first round, twice in the second. Mercanic checked his senses. Checked Frazier's senses. Right. It's target practice for George Foreman. It is target practice. Frazier is ready to go again. Joe is standing. There he goes. Three times. The fight is stopped. No, it is not. It is not stopped. Angie Dundee is screaming, stop it. Bertie Pacheco, Ali's doctor next to me. It is over. It is over. It is over in the second round.
About 2 years ago, my half-sister Jane took her own life. I hadn't seen Jane for many years, but I lived with her briefly at 9 years old for a few months, and then from the age of 11 until I was about 19 or 20, I lived with her, and this was back in the 80s. I hadn't seen her for many, many years. And, you know, the atmosphere we lived in, back in a house we called 858, was shockingly bad. It was a bad atmosphere. But what I can tell you about Jane was she was a very fun-loving person and a big, big animal lover. But back in the 80s, I'd noticed signs of OCD with her. Of course, I didn't know it was OCD. It's only, you know, with hindsight, looking back. We had both developed signs of OCD in that household that we lived in, that you could literally cut the atmosphere with a knife. Because what had happened is my mother had moved in with my biological father, and Jane was his daughter. It was a strange atmosphere. But anyway, long story short, 2 years ago, Jane took her own life. And I was talking to a friend of hers. I think it was, you know, either just before the burial or just after. And she had mentioned that Jane had been planning to take her own life for some time. And that she was having thoughts that she couldn't get out of her head. Now that suggests to me intrusive thoughts, pure awe. And all the time, there I was, her half-brother, doing videos on YouTube that was seen all around the world to do with intrusive thoughts, helping people. You know, I chose the theme of HOCD, but intrusive thoughts nonetheless. And she died because of intrusive thoughts, which I didn't know about. And, you know, I don't feel guilty, because I didn't know. But I do feel bad, and I do feel sorrow, and I do feel compassion. And I wished that I'd helped her, because she really needed it. So why am I saying all this? Because there's a lot of people out there, especially in the theme that I deal with, HOCD, that have thought about taking their own life. And that makes me sad. It makes me sad because, you know, what you have to understand is if you're thinking of doing this, don't. It's only a mental health problem, and it can get better for you. There is a solution. There is a solution. There's been a lot of people, I'm not saying who are suicidal, but have said to me, "Jesse, help me, help me, help me." And they already know what to do, at least some of them do. But they've frozen, paralyzed by fear. And it puts a lot of pressure on me because how can you help somebody that won't help themselves? And what I find is, and I'm pretty sure I'm accurate here in some ways, that when some people are suicidal, they're either one, too lazy to actually take action because they've had everything spoon-fed to them all their life, or they are so paralyzed by fear. It's really simple. There's, you know, between your suffering, which you have now, and recovery, all it takes is one thing. A lot of hard work. You need some hard work. And you can achieve and get out of the mess that you were in. You are a living, breathing human being. You're so much more than your sexuality. There's so much more to a human being than your sexuality. But when people become obsessed, they lose all objectiveness, all outside, external awareness. And they are living life through these tinted lenses. And all they can see is that their sexuality, for whatever reason, isn't functioning properly. And that to them is the end of the world. intrusive thoughts about being gay is the end of the world. But it's not. Now, a lot of people are like, ah, how do I get rid of these thoughts? How do I stop it? How do I get rid of it? I'm gonna kill myself and all the rest of it. Why? Why would you do that yourself? Why would you hurt all your family? Why would you, you know, break the hearts of the people that love you? There's no need of it. There is a way. Do you know what that way is? Not to get rid of the thoughts, to habituate to them, to expose yourself to the thoughts. And by the time you're done, you won't care whether those thoughts are there or not. You want them to leave? There's much more chance of those thoughts leaving if first you get yourself into a position where you don't care whether they are there or not. Then they leave. So, to all the people that's feeling despair, there's no way out. There is a way out, and that's to change, to shapeshift. Instead of fighting the thoughts, instead of suppressing the thoughts, instead of doing all the things that you shouldn't be doing, learn to accept them. And when you accept them, like I said, then there's more of a chance of them going away. You know, any little action that you can take will elevate your self-esteem, will make you feel better. See, these people are suicidal, but yet they won't take action. Isn't it better to confront your fear? I'm not telling you whether you're gay, whether you're straight, whether you're bi, you know, or everything in life is a risk. Isn't it better to risk standing up to your fears and doing exposure therapy than it is just to buy yourself a pair of concrete boots and throw yourself in the river, breaking the hearts of everyone that know you? When, years ago, when I split up, I can even tell you the date. It was the 16th of October, 1997. I split up with a girl that I'd been with for 14 months. And I was absolutely devastated. And funny, me and my sister were talking about it a couple of years ago. And my sister said I'd never seen anybody so shell-shocked in my entire life. And that time, you could literally put your hand in front of my face and I wouldn't have seen it. And I was in a state, a bad state, for about 3 months. And maybe even a year before I could sleep again. And I felt that if I had just allowed it, I would have passed away. That's how low I was. It was like clinical depression. My whole body felt as if it was about a ton in weight. I felt really heavy. And what I did, and this is the way I worked it, is that I give myself false hope. And there's two sides of hope. There's the good side. It's like good twin and evil twin. The good twin is hope, when you can actually take action and do something about it. And then there's hope, where you're just hoping in vain. You are keeping yourself in a state of being hurt because you're still hoping. But anyway, the way I did it was to get out of this. You know, I just felt I wanted to end it all. I was in a period of severe grief. I was in a period of depression. And like I said, I felt if I had allowed, I would have slipped away. So what I did was, I said to myself, well, maybe she'll come back tomorrow. And I made it to the end of the day, because I didn't know if I would. And when I had a couple of hours sleep and woke up, and she still wasn't back, I said, well, maybe she'll come back tomorrow, the next day. And I worked it until I got to about 3 or 4 weeks. And, you know, she wasn't coming back. But I got myself out of the crisis period. Hope and curiosity. That's what kept me alive. But pretty soon, the hope, the evil side of hope, raised its head. Because I was just hoping in vain. And keeping myself in a state of maybe she'll come back, maybe she'll come back. And then I found out she was pregnant by somebody else. And then I found out she had got married to him. She'd moved on. But I got myself out of the crisis period. Action, more than anything else on this planet, is what's going to get you out of the suicide zone. You have to move forward despite fear. See, a lot of people wait to feel ready before taking action. They wait in and waiting and waiting, and they're in a period of waiting, hoping that whatever they're feeling is going to go away. Hoping to get good feelings before they take action, before they do the an exposure exercise, or before they do a mindfulness exercise and let the intrusive thoughts in. Or even if it's standing up to the local bully, people will wait to feel good before taking action. But you've got it backwards. You have to take action first to have the good feelings. The good feelings is the reward. Don't ever, ever take your own life. I've got a support group for HOCD. There are other support groups for HOCD. Mine isn't the only one. And, you know, with my sister Jane, and I did this video to honour her. I don't think she knew she had OCD. I don't think she knew she had intrusive thoughts. And maybe she didn't, but I'm guessing very strongly that she did, judging by what I've heard, and judging by what I've seen in the past. But she didn't know. You out there suffering with HOCD, you know you're having intrusive thoughts and feelings, and you should know that you can do something about it. It's not a forever condition. You may always have a little bit of OCD for the rest of your life. Who knows? Maybe you will, maybe you won't. But it is treatable. There is a way out. I'm the type of person, if I was locked in Tom Sawyer's caves and I tried one way, and I couldn't get out, then I would try another way, and I would try another way, and I would try another way, and I'd keep trying until I got to where I needed to go. Don't be frozen by fear. Feel the fear and take action anyway. You need a mental health professional. You need to do exposure and response prevention. You need to do mindfulness. But what if I'm gay, Jesse? What if I turn gay? That's the risk you're going to have to take. You know, it's very... I've got to be careful what I say. Because very often it's, Jesse's reassuring people. I don't want to do that anymore. I would say, personally, that I think if you have the symptoms of OCD, I think the chances of you being gay are slim. but I can hear you out there now. Or I bet I fall into the minority small percent. I know which way OCD people think. It's everything is a risk. At the core of OCD is uncertainty. And you can get all the reassurance you want, but reassurance cannot beat uncertainty. To use reassurance to beat uncertainty is like turning up at a gunfight with a water pistol. You need to confront your fears head on. And to end this video, because you know me, I go off on tangents and I say all sorts of things. But you know, I've said it before and I'll say it again. There's a hero inside each and every one of us. And to reiterate something that Customato, the great, great Customato, Mike Tyson's old trainer, once said to him, what's the difference between the hero and the coward? There ain't no difference. Inside, they both afraid of dying or getting hurt. But it's what the hero does that makes him a hero. And it's what the coward doesn't do that makes him a coward. Don't feel despair. Any little action that you can take will raise your self-esteem. Any little positive action. Every journey begins with a single step. So step towards uncertainty, step towards your fears, and know that you are worth far, far more than you could ever imagine. The thoughts are only hurting you because you cannot accept them. Once you can accept them, that's not necessarily accepting you're gay, that's just accepting the thoughts. There's a difference. You don't go out and fuck another man. That's not accepting, that's just stupid. Unless you are actually gay. You accept the thoughts. And when you get to that position and habituate to them, it won't matter. Once you file them under unimportant, not worthy of your notice, then they'll go away. Think about it. Anyway, I've spoken enough. You know what I'm like. I talk too much. Anyway, take care, guys. Again, this is in honor of Jane, my half-sister. God bless her. And take care, everyone. Take care out there. Bye for now.